Let's all rise up and look to the Lord in prayer. I'd like to welcome all our brothers and sisters joining us online. Let's look to God in prayer. Our most gracious, loving Heavenly Father, we want to thank you and praise you for this morning, O Lord Jesus. Lord, we want to thank you and praise you for every good thing that you have blessed us with, O Lord Jesus. And Lord, may all the songs we sing today remind us that without you we are nothing, O Lord Jesus. And with you, we can do all great things, O Lord Jesus, in your holy name. Lord, may this time be a reminder of all that we can do by your power, O Lord Jesus, and sing with that abandon, O Lord Jesus. And Lord, we pray that everything that holds us back, we lay it at your feet, all the troubles that we face, because Lord, you will provide for everything, O Lord Jesus. And Lord, in that confidence, we want to sing to you, amen and thank you. In your holy name we pray, amen. His love endures.
Rising to the setting sun, His love endures forever. By the grace of God we will carry on. His love endures forever. Sing praise. We want to sing you praise. Sing praise. Sing praise. Faithful, you will never be. offer you everything. Raise your hands, all you nations. Shout to God of creation. How awesome is the Lord Most High. Where you send us, where you send us, God, we will go. You're the answer. We want the world to know. We will trust you when you call our name. Where you lead us, we follow you.
Can describe the love of our Lord. Amen. But we still sing to Him because it brings us joy, and in His presence we feel complete. Amen. Let's sing Sooner Count the Stars. No claps are enough for our Lord. Let's clap aloud like the stars in the sky.
Enough, no thanks is deep enough, no life is long enough to tell I want.
never turn back time.
I could sooner turn back time.
That you instill so much confidence within us. And Lord, even through our tough times, let us remember of the countless times that you have blessed us. And Lord, while you call us to walk through valleys, you will lift our head up high.
And even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, perfect love is casting out fear. And even when I'm caught in the middle of the storms of this life, I won't turn back. I know you are near.
And I will fear no evil.
Oh, my God is.
I can see the light.
troubles, but until that day comes, still I will praise you, still I will praise you.
Yes, oh Lord. Yes, I will see the light. I will see the light that is coming.
Mighty to save, forever.
Jeremiah 29 is a chapter which is contains a letter written by Jeremiah to the people in exile. These are people, slaves, captured, taken away into exile in Babylon. And to them, the message of the Lord comes this way. For I know the thoughts that I think towards you, says the Lord, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. Then you will call upon me and go and pray to me, and I will listen to you, and you will seek me and find me when you search for me with all your heart. And even as we come into a time of prayer, we come into the presence of this awesome God. We come into this presence of the Lord who answers prayer, who has deep, longing, Lord, words of love for us. Words not just remain words, but proven in action on the cross. And he came to show us his love on the cross. And even as we go into a time of prayer, if you would like to join us at the altar, please join us as we look to him in prayer. Abba, Father, we are so grateful that we can come into this special place, the holiest of holies, into such an awesome presence, a place where heavenly beings covered their faces and their feet because of the awesome holiness there. And yet, Lord, you have called us into such a presence. You have invited us. You have made it possible that we are able to come into this beautiful presence because of the finished work on the cross. Because of the blood shed on Calvary, we can come into this beautiful, awesome presence. We are so grateful, Lord. We are so grateful that you have chosen to call us your own, that you have called us your children, that we can call you Abba, Father. We are so honored, Master. For this time, we are so grateful that you have called us into this place, that we are here to meet with you, that we are here to worship you, we are here to receive from you. Thank you. Thank you for reminding us, Lord, that whatever our circumstances, we are not a people without hope, irrespective of how things seem to be on the outside, Lord. Lord, that you are there, that even if the waters seem to overwhelm, even if the fire seems to devour, Lord, your words are there with us, which tells us that the waters will not overwhelm, that even the fire will not leave even a smell on us, that there will be nothing that will affect us, because you are there with us, that your awesome presence, Lord, continues with us day by day, moment by moment. Lord, available whenever we are able to turn to you, whenever we need to turn to you. Thank you, Lord, for such an awesome presence. Thank you for the finished work on the cross. Thank you for what it means for us that we have eternity with God the Father. We have forgiveness for our sins. We have been reconciled again back with the Father. Thank you that we have healing in the name of Jesus. Thank you that we have restoration in relationships, Lord, in the name of Jesus. That in the name of Jesus, every sickness will, Lord, be taken away because you have come to heal us. Lord, very especially we pray for those who are here up front, Lord. Lord, you have heard their cries. You have, Lord, heard them, and Lord, you're putting your hands on their shoulders and telling them, my child, you are with me. Lord, we pray that you will meet each one of these at their point of need, Lord. Lord, whatever they bring to you, Lord, we know you are able to, Lord, bring much more than what they have expected into their lives. Lord, we pray that you will touch, we pray that you will heal, we pray that you will restore, Lord, that you will do a marvelous work in their lives. Lord, we pray that even through the rest of this service, that we will, Lord, be, Lord, built up on your word, Lord. Lord, that we will be secure in who you are for us. Lord, you will continue to speak to us, that you will continue to do business with us, Master. Lord, we open our hearts to you. Lord, we do not want to leave the way we came in. We want to be touched by you, Lord. Lord, we pray in our giving, in our obedience to your word, we pray that you will be honored. This time we commit into your hands. We pray that you will prepare us, Lord, for the week ahead. We pray that you will prepare us to be your salt and light in a world which is in darkness, in a world that does not know hope. We pray that you will, Lord, use us, Master. Lord, we pray that you will prepare us for the days to come. This time we commit into your hands. In Jesus' most precious name we pray. Amen. Please be seated. I'd like to invite the ushers to receive our tithes and our offerings at this time.
Shall we pray together? Our loving and gracious Heavenly Father, to you, Lord, we bring this offering, and we pray that your hand of blessing would rest upon it, rest upon each one who has given as well, Lord, and help us to continue to know that you are our provider, the one who gives and gives and gives. Lord, we pray that through that, we would also give of our hearts, Lord, fully, completely to you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. It's always a joy to have a dedication of a baby, and today is one such day. And it's our joy today to welcome parents who I hope will soon make an appearance. You know, beloved, the family is a divine institution that's ordained of God from the beginning of time. And children are a heritage of the Lord, committed by Him to their parents for care, protection, and training for His glory. And it is important that all parents recognize the sacred obligation and their responsibility to God in this matter. Jochebed of old trained her child Moses after having given him to the Lord. Hannah was pleased to give Samuel to the Lord because she was so conscious that the Lord had given him to her. Joseph and Mary also brought their little one to the temple. Lois and Eunice, the mother and grandmother of Timothy, influenced, trained, and directed Timothy to be God's servant. And so today, we have Andrew and Rebecca, who are standing before us today with their child and recognizing the sacredness of their charge. They now bring to the Lord the treasure which He has entrusted to them. In so doing, they publicly acknowledge their responsibility for the nurture of this child in the ways of righteousness and godliness. Will you pray with me? O God, our Heavenly Father, Creator of all things, source of life, we praise your glorious name that you have blessed Andrew and Rebecca with a beautiful child and have filled their hearts with joy and gladness. Accept our gratitude and thanks through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Andrew and Rebecca, I have a couple of questions to ask of you. I know that you take seriously the gift that God has given to you. We always know that when God wants to birth a child in this world, He looks all across the world to see which parents would be best suited for this child. And He chose you both to be parents of this little one. So I'd like to ask you some questions that you would answer in the presence of the congregation here. Andrew and Rebecca, do you desire to publicly present your child to the Lord to be His special possession and to be used for His glory?
Yes, we
do. Do you covenant with God to teach your child the Holy Scriptures and to seek to lead your child to saving faith in the Lord Jesus Christ?
Yes, we
do. Do you covenant with God to set before your child a godly example of prayer, meditation in the Word of God, church attendance, and godly living? You know, beloved, a flower symbolizes the beauty of life. It also symbolizes the meaning of this dedication. Whether a flower is beautiful or not, whether it blooms, whether it comes to its full potential as a flower, depends very much on the nurture that it receives. No flower grows alone, apart from the sunshine and the rain, apart from the soil in which it lives. So too, no child grows alone. May the flower then be a reminder of the beauty of fulfillment and the reward that comes from love and understanding from teaching an example. Let's pray. For all your gracious gifts to us, O God, we give grateful thanks, especially for this young child whom we desire to dedicate this day to you. Bless what we do here to the end, that this child may increase in wisdom and stature and in favor with you and with all humanity. Grant that the vows made here in this service may be faithfully performed. Give all of us some measure of Christ's love and appreciation of children. Help us to do our part in building a world wherein all children may grow up in health and happiness. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. May I? What name have you chosen for this beautiful child?
Ethan
Isaiah Abraham, I dedicate you to the Almighty God, to His will and purposes, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen. Oh, it's precious. I'd like to invite you to turn and face the congregation. Would you come to the center here? Just here. The congregation would like to read something over you, and it's just the knowledge that all of us play a part in the building up of this beautiful child. Let's read this together. Abraham and Rebecca. Amen. We have a gift for Ethan, which is a Bible, and we pray that you would read it to him every day, and then a certificate. God bless you, and you can clap for Barry. There you go. Thank you. Oh, I love dedications. Over the past months, we have felt a sense of urgency here at CAP about the need to increase the amount of praying that we do. And I know that you do it as individuals and families, but to increase corporate prayer as well. For there are just so many needs that we have all across not only our city, our country, our congregation, but across the world as well. Things are becoming so difficult and challenging, isn't it? And we know that God intercedes as His church and His people pray. And Ajay David handles prayer here at the church at Powai, and has drawn up an extensive kind of a prayer network that we will be putting into place. And so you'll be hearing from him in this week or the next week. And I pray that as a church, we would all get not only excited about prayer, but be dedicated and diligent in praying as well. Our confirmation classes are going to be held from May 21st to the 30th of May, and Confirmation Sunday will be the 2nd of June. Also, over the past couple of months, I've had some of you come and ask me about baptisms, and we will have a baptism day on June 1st. And so if that's something that you want to take part, be baptized, then I'd like you to send me a message and we'll meet together. We will have a couple of classes before we actually go for the baptism. So let me know if you're interested in that. This Saturday, I guess, the 20th, Cap is going to be 27 years old, right? Yeah, thank God for that. And so thankful for his faithfulness all these years in leading us and guiding us. And let's, as a church, beloved, commit to just seeking the Lord's heart and seeing what he has for us in the years that are in front of us. Each year he shows us the things that we need to get involved in. And so let's be open. We are the body of Christ. We are the church at Powai. And so God speaks to all of us. And so as you hear things about what you feel we ought to be doing, getting involved in, come talk to our leadership, to me, and we'll see how we can incorporate it. But let's celebrate the 20th with the rededication of ourselves to the will and purposes of God. Amen? All right. I've been reading a book by Stephen Otterburn, and some of you may recognize some of the books he has written. But he wrote this particular book, The Exceptional Life, and it's quite a powerful book. And in it, he says that very often, even among the body of Christ, there are things that diminish or demean or limit us in being who we ought to be as children of the Most High God. And he talks about guilt and shame, resentment, fear, anger, instant gratification, learned helplessness, isolation, and addiction. And he says all of these areas can come to bring us down a notch or two from where we ought to be as God's sons and daughters. And so he says, when you deal with these issues, then hope comes back, love comes back, trust comes back, forgiveness comes back, patience, power, community, and freedom all come back. And you see that list, you think, those are things that I would like to have in my life, isn't it? To have that kind of freedom and trust, etc. But the first list also tells us that there are things in our lives that can inhibit that kind of presence for each one of us. And I thought I'd like to kind of go through at least a few of them and see how we can kind of use it to spur each one of us to take a good look at where we are, allow the Holy Spirit to show us things that maybe we need to deal with, and then continue on this process that we started even before Lent. That started at Lent, to just allow God's Spirit to dredge and bring up things that need to get taken out so we could draw closer to Him. Amen? All right, so today I'd like for us to look at this, the whole idea of guilt and shame. The whole idea of guilt and shame. The genesis of this word, these two words actually, we find in Genesis itself, in the first book in the Bible. And if you turn with me to the third chapter, I believe. We see how guilt and shame first came into humanity. Genesis, the third chapter, and allow me to read from verse 1. Now the serpent was more crafty than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. And he said to the woman, "Indeed, has God said, you shall not eat from any tree of the garden? The woman said to the serpent, from the fruit of the trees of the garden we may eat, but from the fruit of the tree which is in the middle of the garden, God has said, you shall not eat from it or touch it, or you will die. The serpent said to the woman, you surely will not die, for God knows that in the day you eat from it, your eyes will be opened, and you will be like God, knowing good and evil. When the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was a delight to the eyes, and that the tree was desirable to make one wise, she took from its fruit and ate, and she gave also to her husband with her, and he ate. Then the eyes of both of them were opened, and they knew that they were naked, and they sewed fig leaves together and made themselves loin coverings. They heard the sound of the Lord God walking in the garden in the cool of the day, and the man and his wife hid themselves from the presence of the Lord God among the trees of the garden. Then the Lord God called to the man and said to him, where are you? And he said, I heard the sound of you in the garden, and I was afraid because I was naked, so I hid myself. And he said, who told you that you were naked? Have you eaten from the tree of which I commanded you not to eat? The man said, the woman whom you gave to me, she gave me from the tree and I ate. Then the Lord God said to the woman, what is this you have done? And the woman said, the serpent deceived me and I ate. We see right here, guilt and shame. Guilt made them hide, and their nakedness brought shame to them, that they couldn't come into the presence of God. Guilt and shame have since followed us all through the centuries, and has become a part of who we are as fallen people. And then we see how the redemption that Jesus has brought takes care of that fallen nature. But I'm getting ahead of myself. Let's just look at guilt and shame, and what the reasons are maybe for feeling guilty, right? As children of God, yet sometimes we feel guilty. Guilt comes from being involved in sin, whether it is once sporadic, or it's a repetitive sin, or it's something that we just choose, I'm going to do this. And guilt can only make you feel bad. And if that's all you feel, it will not help you to change your behavior. Because here's what happens. When you feel bad about what you have done, then you want to feel good, right? And self-gratification comes from that sin that you indulged in, isn't it? That's why you indulged in it, because you thought it would give you some form of gratification. And so when you feel that you're a little under the gun, then you want to again gratify yourself, and so you go back to the sin. So just being guilty doesn't in any way change your behavior. But also, we find that when that happens, we come under the control of sin. And when we come under the control of sin, it has the potential to destroy us. Why? Because it breaks our connection with God. And when our connection with God is broken, then we are no longer able to fulfill His purposes for us, which is why we are here on earth. The second reason for feeling guilt is that even after doing wrong and even after repenting of it, we still feel guilty. We ask the question, why do I feel guilty when I ask God for forgiveness? And more often than not, the answer is that we don't fully accept that God has forgiven. We don't really take the Bible at 100% truth. The Bible tells us in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful, He is just, He will forgive, and He will cleanse. And sometimes we ask for forgiveness, but we don't accept that God has actually forgiven us. Why? Because we think that the sin is too dastardly, too stained for God's forgiveness, too dark for the blood of Jesus to cover it. What a fallacy that is, isn't it, beloved? To think like that, that the precious blood that was shed at Calvary cannot cover the sin that we have indulged in. And so we walk on feeling guilty. But shame, on the other hand, is different. Shame is a question of identity. Shame takes over every aspect and dimension of a person, sucks out their life, and compels them to live a little underneath what God expects us to live. You see, when we have guilt, we are guilty about something that we did. When we have shame, we are guilty of who we have become. We accept the shame as an identity change. We think of ourselves as shameful people. Whereas guilt only has something to do with a behavior. Shame has something to do with identity. It changes the way we look at ourselves. That's why it's so destructive. And very often, the shame that we carry is unwarranted shame. It's shame that we ought not to carry, because maybe that shame was placed, some behavior pattern was placed on us. We didn't have a choice in the matter, but we feel shame. And that shame is not yours, beloved. It belongs to the one who did that wrong over you. And shame can come even from thoughtless words that may be spoken to you as a child. So we need to be very careful as we look at shame in our lives, whether we've accepted it. Because shame goes deeper than guilt. Shame is destructive from the inside. It's insidious. It doesn't allow you to be who God wants you to be. Because every time you want to fulfill a desire from the Lord, Satan uses that shame to tell you, how can you do that? Look at yourself. Look what you did. You're a shameful person. How could you even think of doing that? You're unworthy. And those are the words that we buy into. And once we've bought into the fact that we are not worthy, then every promise, every purpose that God has for us will not find fulfillment. What is the consequence of both guilt and shame? Well, one of the consequences is that we begin to start judging ourselves. We begin to start judging ourselves. The weight of guilt and shame brings self-condemnation to us. Constantly we are telling ourselves we don't match up. We're not worthy. We're not good enough for this. And then, of course, Satan piles on to that place that we have nurtured in our being. And then he makes that his home. And so every time we try to break out, he stifles us with that knowledge, calling us a shameful person. And the temptation, beloved, is to buy into that. The temptation. And I say temptation, because temptation is something that you and I can handle. We think that we cannot. When in this place of guilt and shame, we think we have no options. But guilt and shame are there because we give into temptation perpetually. And yet 1 Corinthians 10:13 has such beautiful words. It says this, but remember this, the wrong desires that come into your life aren't anything new and different. Did you hear that? The wrong desires that come into your life are not new or different. It says many others have faced exactly the same problems before you. What happens when temptation comes? Satan comes with that temptation and says, you're the only one who gets tempted in this area. You're the only one. You're just despicable. And we buy into that thinking, I've got to keep quiet because my goodness, imagine the shame of having to share this with somebody else. And the moment we start thinking like this, he's isolated us and he's got us. But what is God saying? No temptation that comes to you is not experienced by everybody else. Why is God saying that? Because God wants to take that area into the light. The moment you begin to talk about it and say, hey, I experienced this, somebody else says, I do the same. Me too. And then we're able to then say, hey, next time I'm tempted, can I call you? Pray together. And so there's accountability. And then there's victory. Many others have faced exactly the same problem before you. And hear this, no temptation is irresistible. No temptation is irresistible. There's no temptation that you cannot resist. This is the word of God. God is saying, every temptation that comes to you, you can resist. He goes on to say, there is no temptation that becomes so strong that you cannot stand against it. In other words, God knows the temptation that is coming to you and He allows that temptation. He's not the source of it. He allows it saying, I know that you can handle it. I know that you can handle it. Always, of course, handling it in His strength, right? And so God allows it. And then He says, thirdly, He will show you how to escape temptation's power so that you can bear up patiently against it. So He says, I'll also provide a way out for you in that temptation. And so, beloved, just under the weight of guilt and shame, and you think that as the temptations keep coming, that there's nothing you can do, there is. You can take the word of God and slam it against that temptation and say, there are 3, 4, 5 things that this verse says to me. And above all, my God is faithful and He will not allow me to be tempted more than I can handle. That's the word of God. And you can square away from that temptation and say, I resist it. Because there is no temptation that is irresistible. But there other things that guilt and shame do to our lives. They also poison us. They try to take over the rest of us. Have you ever bought a box of strawberries? You go to the store, you buy strawberries. Or they sell them even at junctions, right, as you travel. Boxes of strawberry, and the top looks so good. You take it home and you open it, and inside you find one rotten strawberry. If you don't take that rotten strawberry out, what happens? The whole box is gone, right? The whole box is gone. That's what guilt and shame can do for us. Because guilt and shame gives Satan a platform in our lives to then begin to try and change every other part. Every other part. And so it poisons us. Not just that area of guilt and shame, but other areas as well. Secondly, it makes us feel unworthy of love. It makes us feel unworthy. We think I'm so worthless that I can't really be a lovable person. We don't accept the love of God itself. And yet when we look at the scriptures say God loves us irrespective of how we are, isn't it? Or what we do. While we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. While we were yet sinners, He died. For the joy set before Him, He endured. We're joy. We are His joy. Set before Him, He endured the cross. God loves us so much. And yet with this sense of unworthiness, we stop and say, I can't accept that love. I'm not worthy to accept that love. And even beyond that, we don't accept the love from people around us, right? The moment people get close, you feel that sense of love beginning to grow, you distance yourself saying, I can't receive it because I'm unworthy of that love. I'm a shameful person. If you only knew who I am, you wouldn't want to love me, is what happens. And then thirdly, it keeps us in the past. It keeps us in the past. You know, one of the things that happens when we have guilt and shame is that the moment we have a little bit of quiet time or downtime, guilt and shame will come up and surface, and this particular area gets brought up again. And so we dwell on that. We dwell on that, we feel bad for what happened, and then we say, my goodness, I'm so sick. Why did I do something like that? How did I get myself into that position? And instead of enjoying the present and embracing all that God is doing or wants to do in your life, we are stuck in the past. And if you can't embrace the present, there is no future. There is no future. Your future is just the next day. It's a matter of rote. You get up in the morning and say, okay, what do? I do this, 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 this. You go. There's no joy. There's no peace because there's no fulfillment of purpose. So how do we give up guilt and shame, beloved? The first thing, I think, is taking a good, hard look at the event that brought on this guilt and shame. And ask yourself, does it really belong to me? Does that guilt and shame really belong to me? Am I the guilty person here? If you remember 2 Samuel 13, I think it is, where Amnon, David's son, lusted after Tamar. And he went and he forced her, he slept with her, raped her, actually. And then he actually threw her out. He said, get rid of this woman. And Tamar cried, and the words that she said were so haunting. She said, don't do this. Where will I go with my shame? Where will I go with my shame? And the thing is, that wasn't her shame. It wasn't her shame. She had no power to stop it. He was more powerful. He was the son. And he took advantage of her. She was exploited. She couldn't get out of that situation. The shame belonged to Amnon, not to her. And sometimes we find that we have carried shame for many years when it really didn't belong to us. It belonged to somebody who perpetrated that shame, a shameful act upon us. And we've carried it and let it become us. It's changed our identity into something. We think we are unworthy because of what happened. But the shame doesn't belong to you. Beloved, God wants to draw you close. God wants to embrace you and tell you, that's not who you are. That's not who you are. You are my son. You're my daughter, precious in my sight. You are worthy because you're made in my image. Not for anything else. You're made in my image. That makes you worthy. And I want to love you. I want to care for you. I want to bring healing to you. Maybe, beloved, that's where you may be today, that you've carried shame for many years, many decades maybe. And maybe today God is saying, you don't need to. You don't need to. Give it to me. Give it to me. I'll take it away from you. I'll restore you to the kind of man or woman you were meant to be. Maybe this morning you are one who carries shame because of something that you have done that you're guilty about. And maybe today God is saying to you, you think that that thing you did is beyond the scope of my forgiveness? You're wrong. You're wrong. Nothing, beloved, that we can do is beyond the scope of the precious blood of Calvary. shed at Calvary. Nothing. Maybe this morning, this thing that you think is so bad is something that God is saying, give it to me. I'll take it from you. You've carried it for too long. I'll bring restoration to you. I will forgive, I will cleanse, and I will restore hope for you. Because that's what goes, isn't it, beloved? When we buy into being shameful and unworthy, hope disappears from our lives. There is no hope for us. And you know something? Every 15 or 16 seconds in the world, somewhere in the world, somebody takes their life. Somebody commits suicide. Every 15, 16 seconds. If we just time 15 seconds, one person would have committed suicide. That's the alarming statistic in this world. Why? Because there's no hope. That's what goes when shame takes root. I wonder today whether there are any of you who are saying, I really have no hope for the future. I don't have a plan. I don't have any vision for what I want to do. I just go through the motions day after day. And I wonder whether God is saying, no, I am the restorer. He told the children of Israel, I can restore to you the years that the locusts have eaten. Can you believe that? Restore the years. That's what he can do. As Ajay mentioned, even in Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the thoughts that I think towards you, thoughts of peace and not of evil, to give you a future and a hope. To give you a future and a hope, he tells the children of Israel, in the midst of their exile, when they think all is lost, he says, I'll give you hope. I'll give you back a future. And maybe you're sitting here thinking, everything is gone from me. I may have the facade of somebody who's got it all together, but deep inside, I'm a shameful person, unworthy of anything. And God is saying to you, you're my child. You're my child. My son gave his life for you. That's why he came into this world. Maybe today he's calling you and he's saying, come, I want to give you a future. I want to give you a hope and a future. Without the shame, beloved. Without the shame. Without the guilt. Just to take it all and give you back a sense of freedom. I love the song that we sing, My Redeemer Lives. Because one of the words say, my shame is taken away. My pain is healed in his name. How true, isn't it, beloved? When we have shame, we have pain as well. Right? There's so much of pain in our hearts, in our lives, because of that shame. My Redeemer lives, and therefore, all of this will not have a hold on me. I heard a beautiful song by a contemporary group called 10th Avenue North. Some of you may listen to their songs. But the lyrics go like this, so many times I haven't been true, I've kept myself from you. Didn't know I could be honest, I thought you'd walk away. But then there are times grace gets in and I can tell it like it is. No more lies keeping light from my shadows, got me feeling like a boy who has no shame. I'm so free, yeah, it feels like I'm stealing. I'm so free, I ain't scared of the ceiling. I can look like a fool and enjoy it. I can cry like a man and I own it. It may look like I'm broke, but I'm healing, learning to bring everything that I'm feeling. So forgiven, man, it's hard to explain it. I'm finally living with no shame. I'm finally living with no shame. And maybe that's something that you need to take away with you today, that I'm finally living with no shame. I think that's a good place to close, because God is the only one who can do that thing that you want Him to do, to take care of the shame. Beloved, I'd like to pray for those of you who are saying, I've carried it for too long. It's changed me into a person I don't like. And so I ask, I'm not going to ask you to get up, not going to ask you to come to the altar. I'm just going to ask you all to bow your heads. Just bow your heads, close your eyes. Don't look around. I don't want this to be a moment. I just want it to be a moment between you and the Lord. And then, if I may, if God is speaking to you today, I'd like to pray for you. All I ask is that you put your hand up and then wait till I've seen your hand and put it down. Just lift up your hand and then put it down. Yes, 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 yes. Anyone else? Anyone else? Yes, yes. Yes, yes, yes. Abba, oh Heavenly Father, we come to you. You are the source of life. Lord, I pray for each one of these who put their hands up saying they need you right now to do something in their lives, to restore hope, to remove shame and guilt, and to fulfill your purposes in their lives. Lord, I pray, Lord, that you would take away that shame. I pray that 1 John 1:9 would be stamped upon their hearts, Lord, letting them know that you have heard their cries, that you've forgiven them and cleansed them. And Lord, even beyond that, oh Master, I ask that your love would pour into them in fresh new ways, in ways that they can accept it, Lord. That they would feel your goodness pouring into their lives. Oh, Heavenly Father, touch them, Lord. Let hope arise afresh in them. And may peace and joy be their constant companions. And may they walk in newness of life each and every day. And we pray this with confidence, because we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Let's all rise for our closing hymn.
Come unto Jesus, all you who are weary. Come to the mercy seat fervently near. He'll heal your wounded heart, broken and needy. Come unto Jesus, mighty to heal.
Joy for the comfortless.
Joy for the
church, I'm just going to stop that song right there. It's a beautiful song of invitation. And I believe that the Lord has placed that on Daniel's heart. I believe too that there are many of you who might want to just come to the altar and just sit here, lie down, do whatever you want at the altar, but talk to the Lord this morning. So as we sing this song, I want you to feel free to come and just meet with the Lord.
Come unto Jesus, all you who are weary. Come to the mercy seat fervently near. He'll bring your wounded hearts, broken and needy. Come unto Jesus, mighty to heal.
Joy for the comfortless.
Joy for the comfortless, light for the strained, hope for the penitent, peace in our strife. Here speaks the comforter, tenderly saying, my yoke is easy, my burden is light.
Come unto Jesus.
Come unto Jesus.
Beloved, would you go from here with these strong words of assurance etched upon your hearts? Know that whom the Son sets free is free indeed. In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Please be seated. Dearly beloved, the parents of young Ethan,